There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living home. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living home. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood
come thou fount of every blessing, turn my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. And I was lost in utter darkness till you came and rescued me. I was bound by all my sin when your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone. Come now, bound, come now. Come thou precious Prince of Peace, heal your bride, do you receive? Come thou fount of our blessing, come thou fount, come thou King. Come thou precious Prince of Peace, heal your bride, do you receive? Come thou fount of our blessing. Go to grace, how great a debtor, manly I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy hearts above. Oh, come now, bound. Oh, come now, King. Come now, precious Prince of Peace. Heal your bride, do you receive? Come now, bound of our blessing. Come now, bound. Oh, come now, King. Oh, come now, precious Prince of Peace. Your bride to you we sing, come thou fount of our blessing. Something had to give, something had to give. 'Cause living my life so wild and free, finally caught up, oh, it left me broken, left me hopeless. But that's where I met Jesus, and in one moment everything changed. I was, God washed away. When mercy found me, my Savior's arms were open wide, and I felt love for the very first time. When mercy found me, when mercy. Those days and all those doubts, they don't seem to matter now. His grace is all I need. Oh, His grace is all I need. The chains that I was in before, they don't hold me anymore. His love has rescued me. Oh, His love has set me free. And in one moment, everything changed. Who I was got washed away. When mercy found me, the Savior's arms were open wide, and I felt love for the very first time. When mercy found me, when mercy found my mind, found peace, my soul.
It's your kindness.
It's your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. It's your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. And your love is better than life.
One more time.
It's your kindness, Lord, leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire. It's your beauty, Lord, that makes us stand in silence. And your love is better than
we'll be in the 14th chapter of Luke this morning. If you have your Bibles, we'll turn there. And I'll tell you what. Before we go there, I want to say, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, you need one. You don't need a religion, you need a relationship. And if you have that relationship, I would encourage you before this day is over to be in prayer. Find him. Invite him into your life. Repent of the things you've done and turn away from them and start to go a different way. And you know, eternity is a real thing. It's coming for all of us, one way or another. And you know, as we pray for John's sister, there are a lot of people heading the wrong way. And praise God, he's given each and every one of us the opportunity. And pray that, and we should continue. You should continue to pray that John's sister will be saved. The 14th chapter of Luke opens with an invitation for Jesus to come to a dinner at a Pharisee's house on the Sabbath day. And this is an interesting invitation because it's going to result in Jesus speaking to the demands of the kingdom. It opens like this, 14 verse 1. Chapter of Luke. It came to pass as he went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath day that they watched him. See, this Pharisee had invited the Lord Jesus into his own home for a meal, and the invitation wasn't out of civic duty, it wasn't out of appreciation. This was a trap. This Pharisee had invited Jesus in on the Sabbath day, particularly to eat. To find an occasion at this point in time, Jesus is getting near and near his death. They were trying to find an occasion with which to accuse Jesus. So they set this trap. It says, and they watched him. Verse 2, it says, and behold, boy, it doesn't take long to find a trap. And behold, there was a certain man before him which had dropsy. And Jesus answering spake unto the lawyers and Pharisees, saying, is it lawful to heal on a Sabbath day? Say, it says Jesus answering, and as I look at the text, I don't see the question. If you look at yours, I don't think you'll see it either. What was he answering? Well, Jesus was seated in this home of the Pharisee. He saw the setup, and he quickly realized that the whole thing was a trap. And you see, he was invited to eat on the Sabbath day in the home of a good religious Jew who believed that you could do no work on the Sabbath. So here's Jesus invited into this house on this day to break bread. And as he is seated, he looks before him. Here's this man who has a problem. He has his dropsy. And, you know, that's an unfamiliar term to us. Dropsy, it's what our medical doctors would call edema. And that might still be a weird term to you. Edema is a abnormal gathering of fluids in the soft tissue of the body causing swellings. Many causes of it, you look it up, one of the causes can be congestive heart failure where liquids aren't removed. And I can only assume because Jesus so quickly recognized the situation and probably this dropsy had caused this man's face to swell, that he man was seated before Jesus with a swollen face. And the Pharisees were placing their bets on something particular. They were placing their bets on if they invited Jesus into the house on the Sabbath day and they invited this poor man to sit in front of him, that Jesus couldn't resist healing him. And therein you have this trap. And as soon as Jesus would heal him, they were ready to spring into action with their accusations. And I'll tell you what, as you begin to read about these exchanges between Jesus and the Pharisees, and you see these continual interactions between them, these continual traps, if you look at it, you see that the expectations that these Pharisees had was that Jesus could not resist helping the helpless. Their expectation was that Jesus couldn't resist doing something supernatural to the benefit of those in need. You need to digest that. You need to let that roll around in your head for a moment. These Pharisees who were so set against Jesus Christ recognized that he had ready access to supernatural power. They knew that. Now, these things are hard for me to get my mind around as I look at them. Not only did they know that Jesus had ready access to supernatural power, they knew according to prophecy, especially to the prophecy of Daniel, that the date was drawing near when the promised Messiah would be revealed in Jerusalem. So they know that that's coming soon. They know that this Jesus Christ can't resist doing supernatural acts for the needy. And they're resisting. It's not that they can't put the dots together. They're resisting connecting these dots. Take it back a little further. When John the Baptist baptized Jesus in the River Jordan, and God was so proud that he said from heaven in an audible voice, "This is my son in whom I'm well pleased," there were Pharisees there. Do you think these Pharisees didn't have news of that? Look at what they knew. Look at what they'd seen, what they'd witnessed, and what they were denying. And as you say, how can that possibly be? Do you realize that this is the same condition of most people in the world who call themselves Christians today? This is the very same condition. People who've been so patterned by religion that they can't receive the truth. So proud of the church that they attend that truth is a threat to them. So entrenched in what seems to be religiously impossible that the Holy Spirit can't even move in their midst. Religion. So entrenched in their religion that the Holy Spirit can't move in their congregation, they can't move in their lives. Because that's outside the boundaries that we've set for God. That there are so many people trusting more in religion than in their relationship with Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you what, as we go forward as a church, we have to constantly work to keep ourselves free of religion and open, that the Holy Spirit of God can move here. Because you see, sometimes God's going to move in ways that we don't anticipate. Sometimes it's going to look in ways we don't expect it to look. And if we're so closed up to it, we'll say, that can't be of God. It's not what we've thought. Just like these Pharisees said, Jesus Christ can't be the Messiah because this is not the Messiah we built in our minds. It doesn't fit the mold we've made for him. Even though we can look at our scripture and we can see he fits that perfectly, he doesn't look like the idea we had. And the same is true for the Holy Spirit as he moves. That if we're so closed up by religion and he moves different than that, that we'll miss it. If we're a people who, when the Spirit moves, we don't move with him, he'll go move somewhere else. So we need to keep ourselves open. You know, it was interesting to me last week, if you were here last week, we had a couple Gideon's here. Not the one speaking, but one of the audience was from a large Warsaw church, and he was absolutely taken by the sermon he heard. He spoke to Jim about it. He spoke to me. He told me he'd never heard anything like that. Now, I've heard that statement here before a few times, and always from long-standing members of denominational churches, and maybe I'm foolish. Maybe I misunderstand. Maybe I hear what I want to hear, but maybe when I hear them saying that was something special, and maybe they weren't saying that was good. Maybe they're saying, man, that was a train wreck. But I don't think that's what they're saying. I don't think that's what they're saying at all. I don't think that's what this guy's saying, because he said, I'll be back. I'll definitely be back. Well, number one thing I've heard, I've learned, when they say I'll be back, they'll never be back. So let's not count on that one. When they walk out and you say, boy, I don't know what they're thinking, those people come back. It's just the way people are. Well, that was interesting to me, because I put together what I thought was a short, pretty high-level, easy sermon just to allow them time for your presentation. But what I see in that exchange is that what this man found here was different than the prescriptions of religion that he's used to. That he's probably sat in a church for decades, and we do this and this and this, and we have empty readings, and nobody understands what's being said, and the praise is dead, and this felt different when I came. Praise God, this man was open enough to receive last Sunday. You know, you look around this room, we're not many people. We're just a small church, and most people looking upon us would see a small town, nothing church. But yet, time and time again, I see people who come in, and if they come in with their eyes open and their hearts unguarded, they experience a God-ordained kingdom-expanding church. They find a place that's not for the lost sinner so much, but it's for the Christian to come in and learn so you can go out and you can expand the kingdom of God. So back to the text, and in sensing the setup, Jesus addressed these Pharisees in verse 3 with a question. He said, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? He sees this man in need in front of him, and he turns and he asks this question, and I would imagine at this question that there was only silence. I work with a guy who would describe a moment like this as crickets. You could only hear the crickets chirping in the background. Verse 4 says, and he took him and healed him and let him go. So Jesus heals this man and answered them, saying, which of you shall have an ass or an ox fallen into a pit and will not straightway pull him out on the Sabbath day? And they could not answer him on these things. So Jesus, you see, healed this man before their eyes. And as always with the healings that Jesus performed, you can see there is no hoopla in the healing ministry of Jesus Christ. If you look at the healing ministry of men, the fake healing ministries of men, you see lots of pageantry and hoopla. Jesus just went about the business. He simply did it. This man was completely well. And I want you to see that because this man's affliction, his dropsy, or droopsy, however you want to say it, affected his appearance, that Jesus healing him meant that his appearance immediately changed. And when we read of this particular healing, I don't think we think this is spectacular at all, but this was spectacular. Think about being around that table with a man whose face is probably swollen like a basketball, and Jesus says healed, and his face returns to normal. This was spectacular. This was a visually remarkable miracle. Jesus did lots of remarkable miracles, but they weren't all visually remarkable. This one was visually remarkable. The witnesses of this couldn't mistake it. But as remarkable as it wasn't so remarkable that it would move these Pharisees out of the bondage of their religion. It's evident by the text that the Pharisees didn't approve, even though they said nothing. These men wouldn't bend to truth. It says, so Jesus answered them a second time. Again, well, they're asking lots of questions without moving their lips, aren't they? He answered this second question they didn't ask because these men knew perfectly well the answer to what Jesus said. That they would rescue an animal immediately which had fallen into the pit on the Sabbath day. Because under their laws, the laws that they have taken from God and made so complicated that no man could follow them possibly, they had written into the law a loophole, a provision that if your donkey or ox would fall into a pit on the Sabbath day, you could pull it out. And that would not be counted against you as work. Because that was monetarily of value to you, see. They didn't want to take a monetary hit themselves. So Jesus, as their thoughts were coming against him for healing this man that has more value than any animal, Jesus reminds them of their own loopholes for the benefit of an animal. And again, crickets. Chirp, chirp, chirp. They had nothing to say. So in the silence of the Pharisees, Jesus turns to address the other invited guests in the house around his table as he observes them jostling for the most prominent seats. Verse 7 says, and he put forth a parable to those which were bidden or invited when he marked or noticed how they chose the chief rooms, saying unto them, when thou art invited of any man to a wedding, sit not down in the highest room or the highest place, lest a more honorable man than thou be invited of him. So Jesus, sitting at this meal on the Sabbath day, that's sitting in this trap, begins to speak of a situation of being invited to a marriage feast, which was all important to the Jewish people. And in telling about this wedding feast, he brings about to their minds an embarrassing situation where you're invited in and you set yourself at the head of the table, even though you know you probably don't belong there, and the host accepts another guest in the house, and this one's more important to him, and he comes up to you and taps you on the shoulder and says, sorry, this seat's taken, and all eyes are on you, and as you get up and you go to a lesser place to be seated at the table, it's a time of great embarrassment. Verse 9 says, and he that bade thee, or he that invited thee, and this other man, come and say to thee, give this man place, and you go to this lower seat. Verse 10, but when you are invited, go instead and sit down at the lower seat. And when he that has invited you comes, he might say to you, friend, come sit at a better place. Then you shall have worship in the presence of them that sit at meat with thee. Then you will enjoy that place of prestige. Verse 11, for whosoever exalts himself shall be brought low or abased, and he that humbles himself shall be brought up. So here sits Jesus at this meal after healing this man, watching these other guests come in, scrambling for the best seats for themselves, and observing what they were doing, seeing what was going on. Jesus saw that a far greater sin of these peoples was that these Pharisees were assuming for themselves the chief seats in the kingdom of God. That through their religion, they thought themselves to be at the head of God's table. Look at verse 9. It says, when he that has bid thee comes, or when he that invites thee comes, who's this referred to? Who's this parable referred to other than Jesus Christ, the master of the Messianic wedding banquet was before these people. The groom was before these people. And he was confronting himself with the unpalatable task of demoting a proud and arrogant, unscrupulous priest, putting them in their place. Jesus was the one coming to them saying, these seats, I'm sorry, aren't for you. And as they get up, and move to a lesser place, Jesus is sitting where they were in these prominent seats, sinners and harlots. People who were ultimately more aware of their sins than were the Pharisees. People who ultimately would become repentant for the sins they had committed, where these Pharisees thought that they had nothing to repent for. Humility, simple humility would have saved these priests, these Pharisees. But they're too proud. One of the marks of true greatness is humility. Most of the great people in history had humility. A lot of them have been very humble. I think of myself, I think of one of the greatest people I've seen in my lifetime is Ronald Reagan. I look at him and I don't see a proud man. I remember a humble man. These Pharisees didn't have that. To the point Jesus was making, if you think yourself too lofty, you'll be brought down low. And you know, I was once an assistant pastor to a man who exalted himself. And today he's out of ministry. He's out of church. He's out of fear of relationship with God. Totally degraded, I believe. But he who humbles himself, the Lord will lift up. If you come before the Lord humble and repentant, he will pick you up. If you come to him proud and haughty, he'll bring you down. And why does he bring the proud down? Out of his mercy. It's not revenge. He brings the proud down out of his mercy so that they might come to this point where they can only look up and say, Lord Jesus, I need you. And the outstanding example of the proud being humbled is Satan himself, who once said, I will ascend. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet God answered to him and said, you shall be brought down to hell, to the lowest places of the pit. It's always God's consistent response to pride. And the greatest example of the humble being lifted up, of course, is Jesus Christ, who humbled himself to come down from heaven for our sins. Humbled himself to come down from heaven to the depths of agony on the cross. And he has been lifted up. He is exalted above the universe. Verse 12, then said he also to him that bade him. So now Jesus is turning from the invited guest back to the Pharisee who tried to set him up. You know, one thing I love about Jesus when I read about him is when he got started, he took care of the whole room, didn't he? He didn't leave anyone out. He was an inclusive Messiah. And that's what it will be for each of us. None of us are going to be left out of judgment. But Jesus will get everyone judged. Either for what we've done for his word, for the glory of the kingdom, or what we've done for sin and ourselves. What we've done in humility or what we've done in pride. Verse 12, when thou makest a dinner or supper, call not thy friends, nor thy brethren, neither thy kinsmen, nor thy rich neighbors, lest they bid thee again and recompense be made. So Jesus is saying, especially to these Pharisees, remember he's talking to, good for us too, but he's saying, don't just always invite people to your house who can pay you back. Now that goes on a lot. 13, but when you make a feast, call the poor, the maimed, the lame, the blind, and you'll be blessed. For they can't pay you back. And even though they can't pay you back, you'll be paid back at the resurrection of the just. That in the eternity that comes, you will have your reward. So Jesus is pointing out the guests that these Pharisees invite typically, and the reason for inviting them is out of a sense of pride. It's who I can be associated with. It's who can invite me to their house later, who can repay me for what I've done. You know, there are so few people on the earth who will do something without the thought of how will I get paid back. The point Jesus makes is it's better to invite people who can repay nothing and have faith that your reward comes later, that your faith in Jesus tells you that you'll be rewarded in heaven for what you've done for the kingdom. Now, don't take the scripture wrong. It's not wrong to invite friends and relatives to your home. It's not saying that at all. What's saying is if you never give any thought to those who can't do anything for you, then you're in trouble. You know, this hits home, doesn't it? It's so easy for us to limit ourselves to people who are comfortable. It's so easy to get caught up in the, I'm going to go to their house, and I know later they'll expect me to invite them, which is fine, and around we go. But, Jesus is speaking of self-centered living. A living that says it's all about me. And we're called to follow Jesus Christ, and that calls us to an other-centered living. That we're called to start living our lives in a way that focuses not on what I can get, but what I can give. I'll tell you that Donna and I aren't the best at visiting with people for dinner. I wish we were better. But when time comes that someone needs us that can't do anything for us, I'll be there. I wish you had more social pastor. You don't. But I'm glad you have a pastor who'll go when he's needed. There's something wonderful about giving a gift that can't be repaid. There is satisfaction in that. You don't have to wait to get to heaven to be rewarded for that. There's satisfaction now. This is the more blessing that Jesus spoke of in Acts 20:35 when he said it's more blessed to give than receive. More blessed says there's more blessing in you, more blessing to you if you give instead of receive. And consider God. There's virtually nothing we can give him. Virtually no way we can pay him back, save our love. It's the only thing we have for him. Only thing we can possibly give him. And despite the fact that we have so little to give, God's pleasure is had. He gets pleasure by giving the gift of salvation. It gives pleasure by blessing his people. He gets pleasure by providing for his people. God knows that it's more blessed to give than receive. So Jesus shows how important it is ultimately to live with an eternal perspective instead of a physical perspective. 14, he says, "For you shall be paid back at the resurrection of the just." We will never be losers. We'll never be losers when we give after a pattern of God's generosity. Rob and Misty, you have a great Christmas party. You're all right. They got Christmas. I'm better them than me. How's that? Here, an interesting story. Maybe you've heard before, but I want to read. It says an old missionary couple had been working in Africa for years and were returning to New York to retire. They had no pension. Their health was broken. They felt defeated, discouraged, and afraid. As their trip home began, they discovered they were on the same ship as President Teddy Roosevelt, who was returning from a big game hunt. And no one paid attention to the missionary's wife. And the missionary's wife watched the fanfare accompanied the president's entourage with passengers trying to catch a glimpse of the great man as a ship moved a couple weeks across the ocean. And this old missionary said to his wife, "Something's wrong. Why should we have given our lives in faithful service for God in Africa all these many years and have no one care a thing about us. When this man comes back from a hunting trip, and everyone makes a big to-do over him, well, they give not two hoots about us. His wife said, "Dear, you shouldn't feel that way." And he replied, "I can't help it. It just doesn't seem right." And when the ship docked in New York City, a band was waiting to greet the president. The mayor and other dignitaries were there, and the newspapers were full of the president's arrival. And this old missionary couple got off the ship unnoticed. Off the ship, they found a cheap flat on the east side of New York, hoping the next day that God would show them some way to make a living for themselves. It says that night the man's spirit broke. He said to his wife, I can't take it. God's not treating us fairly. And his wife replied, "Why don't you go to the bedroom and tell that to the Lord?" Short time later, he come out from the bedroom. Now his face was completely different. And his wife asked, "Dear, what happened?" He said, "The Lord settled with me. I told him how bitter I was that the president should receive this tremendous homecoming from a hunting trip, and no one even cared that we came home. And when I finished, it seemed as though the Lord put his hand on my shoulder and simply said, 'You're not home yet.'" You're not home yet. His eyes set on the physical and not on the eternal. That there's something much greater awaiting him and his wife when they step into eternity. You know, we may never receive as individuals, we may never receive as a church any recognition. We may talk every week about the astounding things God's doing through this place, through us, through our lives. And we may know these things are astounding. Next time, I'll continue to look at that little bunch of hicks on the corner. A bunch of nothing. You know, that's all right. You know, not the big mega churches have all their fanfare and all this recognition and the newspaper articles. And that's okay. Ultimately, I don't want them. I don't want them because we don't belong in this world. We're just passing through. We're trying to pass through obedient to God. Trying to pass it through to a better eternity than what we deserve. An eternity that will be full of fanfare. And we need to look forward to that eternity and the day we slip from this world into that eternity and imagine for ourselves what that fanfare will be that day. My gosh, my Bible says that when one person confesses that there's a celebration in heaven, and one confession today there's a celebration in heaven, what will it be when you finish your race and you step into heaven? I think it'll be amazing. I can't imagine what will be. And ultimately, it doesn't have to be anything. There needs to be no band. There needs to be no trumpets, no nothing. But the voice of Jesus saying, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." What more do you need than that? Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Promises ahead of us. And this morning we'll take communion, and if you're here, you're invited to join us. If you don't want to join us, you can let it pass. There's no condemnation in that. Yeah, you will get the kids. She takes up after my shortcomings. She said, "You want me to get the kids?" Always forget them. Well, I would ask yourself as we prepare for communion, you know, where are you at? Are you, you know, the word this morning came early, seemed to be you need to let the past go, that You need to quit limiting yourself, your walk with Jesus, due to the stuff you've done in the past that God's willing to already look as you find a relationship with Him. God's willing to forgive that. He's willing to not see it anymore. And that we so limit ourselves because we're so prone to continue to look at what we've done, look at our shortcomings, and say, I'm not good enough. But yet you are good enough. And Will and Sharon, will you come and help me pass communion today? So, you know, as this passes, I would encourage you to be in a time of reflection and a time of repentance and a time of telling Jesus you need Him. You know, I've taught so many ways with communion, and there's so much that we could go a couple hours and still be trying to uncover everything that holds. But yeah, I think the simplest observance of communion is always the best. I like that we're here as we're studying Luke, and we're getting so near the end of the life of Jesus. And you know, for centuries, the Jews had had Passover that they were to do once a year to remind them of how God had freed them, that how God loved them, how He helped them to escape from Egypt. And the night before Jesus would be arrested, he gathered His disciples in the upper room, and knowing full well what was drawing so near to Him, that He's going to be beaten horribly, that He's going to suffer a horrible death, that wasn't His problem. You know, I think Jesus looked right past that stuff. He's about to carry your sins. He's about to be separated from the Father. Something never happened. You know, we come and we can't imagine how the Father and Son are one and how the Trinity exists, but Jesus is coming to a point of separation. No, death is separation. He's coming to a point of death. His separation from the Father. And all these Pharisees we read about that he'd been debating with, and they'd been trying to trap Him. And we can develop this rigid attitude towards the Pharisees we read about and think of them as the enemy. And yet Jesus looked even upon these Pharisees and He thought, I'll do it for them. You know, John's got a sister who's not saved, who's nearing the end of this life. We pray that her choice is different, because her sins were on Jesus Christ on the cross. And Jesus gathered His disciples that night in the upper room, and they were enjoying that Passover feast that reminded them of what God did for them, getting them out of Egypt. And Jesus, knowing full well what was coming ahead. And during that Passover feast, it says that he took the bread and He gave thanks. He broke it. And He gave it to them, saying, this is My body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me. Those in the room didn't know what He meant, didn't know what He was about to do, didn't know He's about to die. So let's be obedient to the Lord this morning. Let's take and let's break bread. Let's eat. Let's do it in remembrance of Him. It says, likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in My blood, which is shed for you. New Testament, new covenant, new way. And Jesus Christ wants us who have accepted His blood, have accepted the atoning work of His blood that covers our sins, that we're seen by God white as snow. Jesus loved you so much, he's willing to do this. He says, often as you will, take this representation of the blood was shed for you and drink and do it in remembrance of me. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to this time of communion where it's different than the communion we read about between Jesus and the Pharisees this morning. It's a different meal. We come to this time of communion, this Lord's Supper, this meal that we come in obedience that we can remember what Jesus has done for us. And Father, I pray that if there be any in this room that they would begin to open their hearts to you if they don't know you. Father, I lift again John's sister to you. We're such a fortunate people that we have this relationship with your glorious son, and we're asking the same. We're earnestly asking the same for John's sister. I'm asking for John that before she passes, that John would hear her plead the name of Jesus Christ, that he'd have that comfort. We're so thankful for what Jesus did for us. So thankful for the love that you have for us. So thankful for the glory that we don't deserve, but yet it lays ahead of us. In Jesus' most holy name. Amen. So as we close the day, may the word of Jesus Christ, our Savior, abide in you. May you abide in him. May God show you his mercy and truth in great abundance. Go in peace. Go with God. And be ready to be a blessing to someone. The world is quickly darkening, and you have light in you. Go out and be a beacon of light this week.